गुड इवनिंग. सो वी हैव फिनिश्ड द टू मॉडल्स. व्हिच आर द टू मॉडल्स वी स्टडीड आशीष? द वन एटकिंसन एंड शिफ्रिन गियर दैट वाज बेस्ड ऑन थ्री डिफरेंट स्टेजेस और स्टोर्स ऑफ मेमोरी. व्हाट इज इट कॉल्ड?
स्टेज मॉडल.
Stage model, okay. And the last one we learned was about two levels of processing. So the name of the theory would be
learning of
levels of processing by Craig and Lockhart. Okay. And now we are going to learn about the different types of long-term memory. Till now we learned about only three types of memory: sensory memory, short term, and third one was, what was the third one, Amal? Sensory, short term, and long term. So we have some types or subdivisions of long term memory, and that is the one we are going to learn in this class. Okay, I will share the screen now. Okay. Yes. So this is the basic division of LTM. It is divided into declarative memory and non-declarative memory. Okay. The basic division is declarative. You can draw this flowchart and give. It will be very easy for you to learn because we have some more subdivisions in this. So better you draw a flowchart and keep. Okay, long-term memory divided into declarative memory as well as non-declarative memory. Now, let me ask you a few questions. Okay, Meghna, what is your best friend's name?
Rishma.
Rishma. Amal. When did India get independence? The year. Yeah.
1947.
1947? Tell me, I didn't hear. 1940?
Seven.
Okay. Then, what is your birth year, Ashish? 2004. Sana? What did you eat for breakfast?
Idiyappam.
Idiyappam. Okay. Aishwarya, how do you ride a bicycle?
Pedaling it.
No, explain how do you ride a bicycle. If I don't know, I'm a person who does not know how to ride a bicycle. Okay. How will you teach me?
First, get on the bicycle. Then slowly start to pedal, holding on the brake and the handle.
Okay, I don't know what is pedaling. How will you explain it to me?
There would be pedals on the bike. So
I don't know what is the pedaling. I don't know what is pedaling. I don't know what is a pedal. So how will you explain to me?
There would be a stand-like thing in which you have to keep your foot in.
And
then slowly push it to down.
Okay, imagine I don't know to ride a bicycle. So you're teaching me verbally. You're instructing me this is the way to do. Will I be able to do it properly?
No.
Okay. Now, Meghna, tell me, how do you swim?
I don't know.
Anybody who knows to swim? No. Then, okay, Meghna, tell me, how do you walk?
I step forward, right leg, like that I walk.
You step forward?
With my two legs.
If you step forward with two legs, you fall down with your face on the floor.
No, first right or left, one by one.
One by one, okay. And what should you do with the other leg?
Keep it back.
keep it backward and just put one forward, 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 and just keep the other one backwards and keep, is it? Okay. So when I asked you the other questions, other than the swimming, cycling and walking, you could easily answer me, isn't it? Yes, because there are ready-made answers. We know that it's related to some other form of knowledge, isn't it? The name, the date, there's some famous dates, some major episodes in our life, like the birth year, the major things in our life, like the best friend, all those things that is very easy to answer or describe verbally, isn't it? But when I asked you about the other things, that is walking, swimming, riding bicycle, all these things are some, all these require some skills, isn't it? But is it true that you don't know how to walk, you don't know how to ride a bicycle? No, you know it, but you can't explain or elaborate it verbally, isn't it? So the ones which you cannot explain verbally, or you find it very difficult to explain verbally, that memory goes into the non-declarative memory. As the name suggests, you cannot declare it in front of a group of people. And the declarative memory, that means the ones that you can really verbally explain. Suppose if I ask you to explain about your mom, you can explain easily, isn't it? Her features, the physical features, her behaviors, her characteristics, the values that she holds, all those things, isn't it? But again, if I ask you, explain how your mom walks, will you be able to do that? Again, you can show it, but you can't explain it verbally, in words. You'll find it very difficult, isn't it? So that is the difference between the declarative and non-declarative memory. And the non-declarative memory, it is also known as procedural memory. This is also known as procedural memory, because it deals with so many procedures, like how to swim, how to walk, how to cycle, how to ride a bicycle. Everything comes as a procedure. It is related to some procedure or doing some skills. Okay. If you want to study how to dance, you go to the dance tutor. The dance tutor simply stands there and instructs you. You have to keep your hand 90 degrees forward. You have to keep your leg 180 degrees backward. And you have to look left, you have to look right. Then you have to place your neck at this particular angle. You have to move with the third beat of the music. Will that be easy, or will you be able to follow the dance tutor? No. For that, you have to do it and then see. That all those requires some procedure and some skills. So all the memory for that procedure and skills comes under the procedural memory or the non-declarative memory. Why is it called a non-declarative memory? Because you cannot explain it in words, or you find it very difficult to explain it verbally in terms of words. That is why it is called non-declarative memory. Now, declarative memory, on the other hand, deals with all the memories that you can really explain verbally. With words, you can explain, or you can learn, you can elaborate on those memories. Like if I ask you, which was the most happiest moment of your life, or what is your ambition in life, then do you remember the first day at your new school? Then if after 5 years I would ask you, do you remember the first psychology class, can you explain about it? Or do you remember the first day you're joining the college, the first friend that you met in your college? All those things you might remember, and you can explain it in words, which is really opposite to that of the non-declarative memory. And Here in declarative memory, we have two more divisions. They are, first one is episodic memory. The second one is semantic memory. Episodic memory and semantic memory. Okay, from the name, can you just guess what these memories might be? Anyone? What might be episodic memory? What might be semantic memory? What might be semantic memory?
Something related to meaning.
Something related to meaning. And basically that's related to the meanings of different forms of knowledge. Okay, the general knowledge, the year, for example, the year in which India got independence, that is something of general awareness, isn't it? We have already understood that in many, and it's been so many years since India got independence, but still we remember that year. But if I ask you, when did you actually learn how to ride a bicycle? Will you be able to give me the year or date or something? No, isn't it? This memory, the semantic memory, deals with all the information related to the general knowledge or information of general awareness. Semantic, general awareness. General awareness, all those concepts we will learn or know in depth, isn't it? Along with its meaning. 1947, we know its meaning. We know all the information about it. 1947, India got independence. We know about the freedom fight. We have studied about the freedom fighters. We have learned about Gandhiji. We have learned about so much of information about the freedom fight. So that's why we have done a deep processing. When we consider this in terms of levels of processing theory, we have done a deep processing about this. And it deals with the general awareness or general knowledge. So all those information, all the memories about those information comes under semantic memory. Now, episodic. What might be episodic memory? Any guess?
Something that remains as episodes.
Yes. Remember, in the chronosystem, macrosystem, microsystem, we learn, no? Major episodes in life are in put in one system. What was that system? It was the last system. Bronfenbrenner's theory. Microsystem, macrosystem. Chronological orders, there will be episodes that are present in the chronosystem, isn't it? If I remember it right, it is chronosystem. Okay, so those episodes in our life, they are important episodes in our life are stored in the episodic memory. The important episodes or important events in our lives, they are stored in the episodic memory. Okay, so this will be more of emotional content, the episodic memory. Like if I ask your parents, do you remember the day your first child was born? Do you remember the day your second child was born? They would have a very good memory about it, isn't it? Because that is very close to their heart. They have some emotional attachment towards that day. So that is a particular important episode or event in their life. So they might remember it in that way, which has a lot of emotional content. In episodic memory, most 99.9% of the memories will be attached to some form of emotion or feelings, because they are the episodes that happen in our own life. Okay. Whereas semantic memory, they do not have any emotional content. When you hear 1947, independence, do you have any particular emotion? other than the holiday that you get during the Independence Day. But those who have lived during that period, during the independence, might have a particular value for that day. That might come under the episodic memory for them, because they might have seen people dying in front of them. They might have seen Gandhiji during the Dandi March. Then they might have even participated in the Dandi March. So all those things are episodes in their lives. So that might include in the episodic memory of their memory system. But for you, it is not an episodic memory. It is just a semantic memory. You just have a general knowledge that India got independence in this particular year. That's all. Understood? Okay, so understood the difference between episodic and semantic. Now, if I ask you what is 2 plus 2, what will you give the answer?
4.
Any other answers? Okay. So again, 2 plus 2 equals 4. That is again what information? Something that we all know. So that comes under general awareness. Did you feel any emotion while telling 4? No. Blank no. So that comes under semantic memory. But if suppose it's your birthday on... When is your birthday, Meghna?
January 1st.
January 1st. Okay. So I'm telling that particular date in class as an example. Just imagine as an example. So for you, it might be special because it's your birth date. So that is an episode in your life, your birth date. For others, it is general awareness. That would become the semantic memory of them, of their memory system. Understood? That is the basic difference between episodic and semantic memory. Now we'll read the text and you'll understand more about it. Okay, take types of long-term memory. Sana, can you start reading? Sana. Sana and Grishma, what happened? The videos are off. Okay, start. Page 136.
Types of long-term memory?
Yes.
As you read in box 7.1, the short-term memory is now seen as consisting of more than one component, working memory. In the same way, it is suggested that long-term memory too is not unitary because it contains a wide variety of information. Mm. In view of these contemporary formulations, envisage long-term memory as consisting of various types. For instance, one major classification within the LTM is that of declarative and procedural, sometimes called non-declarative memories. All information pertaining to facts, names, dates, such as rickshaw, has three wheels, or that India became independent on August 15, 1947, or a frog is an amphibian, or you and your friend share the same name are part of declarative memory. Procedural memory, on the other hand, refers to memories relating to procedures for accomplishing various tasks and skills, such as how to ride a bicycle, how to make tea or play basketball. Facts retained in the declarative memory are amenable to verbal descriptions.
Underline that, amenable to verbal descriptions.
While condense of procedural memory cannot be described easily.
That also.
For example, when asked, you can describe how the game of cricket is played, but if someone asks you how do you ride a bicycle, you may find it difficult to narrate. Helbing has proposed yet another classification and has suggested that the declarative memory can either be episodic or semantic. Mm-hmm. Episodic memory contains biographical details of our lives.
You can stop there. Thank you, Sana. Now, Amal, read.
Ma'am, from the episodic memory?
Yes, episodic memory.
Episodic memory contains biographical details of our life.
Underline that, biographical details of our lives, which means the major events or episodes in our own lives. Okay, not that of others, but our own lives. Something, a memory that is episodic to you might not be episodic to others. Okay, the first day that you joined school or joined college, that might be so much close to your heart, but that might not be episodic to others. Okay, fine. Continue.
Memories relating to our personal life experience constitute the episodic memory, and it is for this reason that its content are generally emotional in nature. How did you feel when you stood first in your class? Or how angry was your friend, and what did she or he say when you did not fulfill a promise? In such incidents, which did actually happen in your life? You perhaps will be able to answer these questions with a reasonable accuracy. Although such experience are hard to forget, it is
equally
true that many events that take place continuously in our life and that we do not remember all of them. Besides, there are painful and unpleasant experiences which we do not remember in much detail, pleasant in our experience.
As compared to pleasant experiences. Okay. So, the next, Elvina, can you read?
Semantic memory, on the other hand, is the memory of general awareness and knowledge. All concepts, ideas, and rules of logic are stored in semantic memory. For instance, it is because of semantic memory that we remember the meaning of, say, non-violence, or remember that 2 plus 6 equal to 8, or the STD code of New Delhi is 011, or that the word elephant is misspelled. Unlike episodic memory, this kind of memory is not dated. You perhaps will not be able to tell when you learn the meaning of non-violence or on which date you came to know what Bangalore is the capital of Karnataka. Since the contents of semantic memory relate to facts and ideas of general awareness and knowledge, it is effect neutral and not susceptible for forgetting.
Okay. Did you understand anything? Switch on your videos. What happened again, Ashish, Sana, Grishma? Okay, so just summarizing the topic. LTM divided into two, declarative and non-declarative memory. In declarative, we have two types again, episodic and semantic memory. In non-declarative, you have procedural memory. So declarative means the ones we can explain in terms of words. That is, verbal explanation or elaboration is possible. You can describe in terms of words for the declarative memory. Anything that is declarative memory can be described in terms of words. But those which cannot be described, or with those you face very difficulty in, those memories are known as non-declarative memory. It is otherwise called procedural memory. Procedural memory examples can be the memory for skills, dancing, walking, riding a bicycle, riding a bike, driving a car. Everything comes under procedural memory, the swimming, all those examples. Now, for declarative memory, we have episodic and semantic. Episodic means all the biographical details, that is, the events, the important events and episodes in our own lives, that comes under the episodic memory. And semantic memory, we have some information in terms of general awareness. Okay, general awareness, general knowledge, all those things comes under semantic memory. It is called semantic. Why? Because we have really done some in-depth processing about the meaning of the concept. You know what is independence? No. You know how you have learned. I am not telling that you know now. You may or may not remember about the whole freedom fight, but you have learned about it. You know, at least you have a bizarre idea of what independence really is. you know about the freedom fight and the freedom fighters, at least some of them, and you know the year 1947, most of you. Yes, so that comes under semantic memory because it is a part of your general awareness, something that everybody knows. But in episodic memory, it's more of emotional content. So Meghna's birthday, she told about her birth date with the year. So it's not necessary that all of us know about it, isn't it? Even our own birth dates, it's not necessary that the rest of the people knows it. But if it is a semantic memory, then it's something that a group of people might know. There's a common understanding about that topic in a group of people. That is semantic memory. Understood? Any doubt in this LTM? Any doubt till this topic, types of long-term memory? Are you reading the textbook at least once a week? Okay, let me ask a few questions. Okay, who gave the stage model?
Atkinson and Shifrin.
Atkinson and
Shifrin.
Shifrin. Okay. Who gave the other model? Levels of processing?
Craig and Lockhart.
Craig and Lockhart. Okay. Now from LTM, if you want to learn how, or you have already learned how to play violin, okay? That comes under which memory? Elvina? Think and tell.
Non-declarative.
Non-declarative, also called?
Procedural.
Procedural memory, because that is also related to a skill, isn't it? You have to hold your hand in such a way. You have to know the notes. You have to know how to use the strings. You have to know how to use that instrument properly. Then only you can actually learn it properly. And you cannot explain to someone verbally that this is the way you have to do. This is the way you have to hold the strings and all. Isn't it? So obviously that comes under procedural memory. Then... Okay, Amal, you told me about your favorite teacher, no? Remember the other day? What was her name? Kalyani, is it?
Makarteni.
Yeah, that one. Yes. So you have a memory about her, how she behaved to you, isn't it?
Yes.
That belongs to which type of memory? Which type of long-term memory?
Episodic.
Episodic, yes. So he remembers that till this particular age. So we know that it has automatically gone into the long-term memory. If it has been in the sensory memory only, then it might have been lost by now. If it has been short-term memory also, it might have been lost by now. Unless he has rehearsed it. The maintenance rehearsal and elaborated rehearsal both has taken place in case of Amal's teacher. That is why he could actually retrieve that information when I asked him. Okay. So that is again an episodic memory. Now, what is 15 into 5? Anyone?
75.
15 into?
15 into 5, right?
Yes.
75.
Any other answers? Are you doing the problem there? Any other answers? Any objections for 75? Okay, thank God. Otherwise, we would not be able to put that in. What memory?
Long term.
Long term. Which of long term?
Semantic memory.
Semantic memory. Yes. If how many are there? 3, 6 of you are there, and 6 of you would give me different answers for 15 into 5. Then that won't be semantic memory, because we need something of general awareness there, isn't it? 15 into 5 is 75. Since you all agree to that, since you all know that it is semantic memory. But if you all have given me different answers, then I would find it really difficult to put it into semantic memory, because semantic memory contains something of general awareness, of general agreement, of general knowledge, something like that. Where is Eiffel Tower present? Elvina's favorite place. Where is Eiffel Tower present?
Paris.
Paris. That is again what memory?
Semantic memory.
Semantic memory. Then you ask questions now. Examples. We will have case studies, okay, for practicals. Actually, 11th, it's not like the 12th standard practicals. We'll have case studies. We'll have some video presentations or something based on the practicals that we have learned till now. So the case studies and all will be like this. It will be based on something related to the theoretical content that we have learned. So we have to apply in daily life and learn. Last time, actually, I was supposed to put application level questions, but it was the majority of the questions was for the internal assessment and all. So, and majority of the questions were one word questions also. So I could not put the application level questions. Maybe during the revision, we'll do that. Yeah, let this be a small revision for that. We'll soon have case studies and the practical sessions. We are planning for that. I have got instructions for that. That's I'm telling. Okay. Start. One example from any type of long-term memory. Don't ask, you just tell me one example each. Is the time up for the class? No. Okay. Start. What happened? Lazy.
Learning or bored? New language.
Learning a new language. What memory is it? No, it's don't tell me the process. It's actually, you have to tell me a memory actually. All these examples are from long-term memory. No, when I asked you 15 into 5, you remembered the calculations, you remembered the answer. 75, you already know that. That is a general awareness thing. So you retrieve that from your memory. Okay, so you have to tell me about the memory.
Dancing, which I had learned dancing by myself, and getting into that much skill by playing with my friends. So it's a type of non-declarative memory
or procedural memory. Okay, Aishwarya's example, we can see it in this way. You have already learned the language English, so that is also a memory. You can use that language, and that comes under which memory?
Non-declarative,
because you can't really instruct a person how to learn a language. The person has to really understand. But use of language, the words that you use, the words that you understand, the spelling of cat, spelling of dog, spelling of ball, spelling of bell, all these spellings that you have in your memory, that comes under which memory?
Semantic
memory. Yes, declarative memory, part of declarative, which is semantic memory, because we all know that spelling. We have a common agreement about the spelling of cat, dog, and all those, unless we are from different countries. In France and all, some extra E, extra F, all those things are added. Okay, then next example. Yes, Ashish.
Learn guitar.
Learning guitar. Okay. Copycat. Then.
Getting prize in a competition.
That is what memory?
Episodic. For me,
it's yes, episodic memory from declarative memory. Okay, then who's left? Amal. Anything, any simple thing. Tell me anything that you remember and you just put that into either declarative or non-declarative. And if it is declarative, put it into semantic or episodic. That's it. Now don't tell me you're suffering from Alzheimer's. Anything that you remember, at least anything that you remember from today, from this day, or anything that you remember from all these years. How old are you? 16, 17.
Ma'am,
Come on.
I'm chatting in Twitter.
Chatting in Twitter. Chatting in Twitter. What's that word?
Yes,
okay, that is what memory?
Semantic.
Chatting with a specific person or generally chatting?
Generally
chatting. Okay, so that is semantic memory. If you have a special memory about a particular person that you have chatted with, then that will come into the episodic memory. Okay, because that is very close to your heart. That is something that you remember with all the emotions, all the feelings. So that might come under what memory? Episodic memory. Understood? So that is the major difference between semantic and episodic. Episodic has something with so much of emotional content, while semantic might not be with the emotions and feelings. Okay, with that we wind up. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.